Well, thank you, everybody. Good morning to you. I appreciate you joining me for Prioritize Crucial Projects, Manage Demands, and Reduce Pressure and Master Multiple Tasks. So today we're going to talk about all about time management. How do we get control of our day when things seem a little bit crazy? So let's get started. Well, maybe we're not advancing. What's the problem here? There we go. All right. So you all probably know me by now if anybody's been on the many other webinars that I've had the privilege to do for you guys. A good deal of my career, over 30 years, has been spent in human resources, and I work as a consultant for Fortune companies, privately held organizations, all things HR is me. And my consulting practice is called Strategic Performance of Los Angeles. In 2019, I released a book called Job Hunting Now What? Keeping It Real in a Modern Career Search. That's been a bestseller this past year. And I'm often out speaking as a media contributor, and here's a few of the places that I've been able to contribute. Mm-hmm. So does this look, I heard somebody say, ugh, right? Does this look and sound familiar, right? Your inbox is overflowing and all of it needs your immediate attention. Maybe your assistant called in sick that day and now you're wondering, what the heck am I going to do? Or suddenly you realize in your horror that you have some things that are due in 10 minutes and you are totally unprepared to deal with it. So does this sound familiar? I bet everybody would raise their hands, right? Yeah. Is there a way to deal with it all? I say, yes, there is. And we're gonna talk about that. So today's agenda is that we're going to discover some organizational skills, time management hacks that actually do work, and manage stress caused by the multiple demands on our time. So let's talk about organizational skills. One of the things that you have heard, and I'm sure this goes back to elementary school, right, where they even tell you to keep your desk clean. And it's not just about the discipline, right, of keeping your workspace clean, but there are a number of benefits that come from keeping a clean desk. Studies have even shown that a well-organized desk also has some psychological perks. They include things like you're more likely to make healthier food choices if you're eating in a clean workspace, improve your mental stability, increase productivity. I would say yes to that's what works for me. And more likely to sleep better because you're not focused on the confusion in your workspace at night. You improve your focus throughout the day and reduce stress. So here's a couple of things that they suggest that we do to make sure that we have a well-organized workspace. Set up processes in your area that create a natural flow, right? So, you know, maybe, you know, you work best, or you could figure out how to work best when your workspace is organized in a way that creates this natural kind of feng shui of things in your workspace, right? How does it flow? What's the easiest way and efficient way to operate in the workspace? Keep only the essential things close at hand. So putting everything else up in a way that is considered non-essential, but labeling storage and then creating a designated spot for all of your tools. So I love having compartments for things, right? Stackable trays, those kinds of things that can help me label and put things in their proper space. So managing your priorities, you probably waste more time in your day than you really realize. Most of us do. It's not just you, trust me. We all probably struggle with this in various areas. What most people have in common, no matter their profession, is that they prioritize the most urgent things without stopping to think whether they're the most important things. According to this 6-year global study that I read, they said 351,000 people, over 40% of their time in the workplace is spent carrying out tasks that ultimately don't matter. We look at it another way, we can think of it this way. Nearly half of our time is wasted. So how can we better make use of our time? One of the ways is to use what you see on the screen now, which is called the time management matrix. So as you can see, it's broken up into four kind of quadrants, right? The Q1 area is what's considered important and urgent. This is where critical issues, emergencies, last minute work lies, working on very important projects that's due the next day. Q2 quadrant is important and not urgent. Principal goals and long-term projects lie in this quadrant. Strategizing and planning for important and long-term projects live here. And then in the third is important and not urgent. Interruptions and distractions, low value busy work, phone calls, replying to emails, time tracking, etc. And then the fourth is not important, not urgent. Time wasting and trivia things, right? Social media scrolling, mindless web browsing. So when you're really busy at work and you're rushed off your feet with tasks, it's easy to overlook distinctions between what's important and what's urgent. These two words often seem interchangeable, but there's a big difference between them. And this difference forms the crux of time management matrix. This matrix is basically a way of figuring out what you should be doing and of learning to approach your commitments more consciously. According to the matrix, everything that we do in life can be sorted by both its urgency and its importance. This creates the following matrix as you see it. As you can see, the top quadrants, as I just shared with you, should be focused what you should be working on. They're important. But you should also be trying to minimize the things that are in Q1, the quadrant that's important and urgent, as much as possible. This quadrant deals with unforeseen issues, unexpected yet pressing problems. But if we spend enough time in Q2, we should minimize the amount of tasks that are urgent and we should deal with. Q2 is all about proper planning and putting the necessary time in before things become urgent. This is the quarter we should be prioritizing, since doing so will help us be more effective in our work and minimize bad work stress. So how do we make time to do this? We identify things that are our priorities. If you want our work to sit mostly in the important and not urgent, we first need to identify our highest priority task. And reorganizing your to-do list based on the grid above will also allow you to instantly identify which tasks need your immediate attention and which are most important. And the second thing will be to learn the art of delegation, which I'm going to talk to you about here in just a minute. So when you look at this, right, we often say everything's a priority, which is not actually true. Sometimes we let our emotions get the best of us, and we cause ourselves to overreact to circumstances, right, based on our emotions. And that's how we tend to get caught up in thinking that everything is urgent, or we accept the emotions of other people, right? How many times do people come to you in the course of your day and say, I need this right now? And it interferes with things that really truly are your priority. And because they are not managing their emotions, you know, properly, they displace the emotion on you, and now they create this sense of urgency for you, when it's not actually probably true. It's probably not an emergency, but their less managed emotions, right, make them think that it is, which makes you think that it is. And I'm going to talk to you about how to manage the stress of other people as well. So another way we can manage these things is to embrace technology. There are so many different tools and things at our fingertips now, right, to help us manage our days, how we get information, how we relay information. And so it's all about how do we leverage those tools that are provided to us. And what I did is I wanted to go out and give you guys what I think are the top 8 task management apps. If you're somebody who's into technology, here's a quick list of the top 8 that might help you best manage your day. Monday.com, Rike, I use Asana, Trello, Workfront, FunctionFox. Kintone is one I wasn't familiar with that I got a chance to read a little bit more about, which seems interesting. And then ClickUp is one that I've used before as well. So here's the top 8 task management apps. And, you know, I firmly believe in what gets planned gets done. And if you can put it in its proper perspective, right, according to our 4 quadrants, and then we use a tool to help us manage it. Another one that I personally have used is this one called the Emergent Task Planner. You can find this out on Amazon. It's for sale a couple of different places. But what I think is interesting is it says, what are the 3 major tasks for today? Realistic expectations equal consistent daily productivity. So I love the fact that, you know, not only does it, you know, help you to plan the day, but it gives you little tips, right, to help you put it in its proper context. If you see across the very top, it says use the day's grid for scheduling and keep notes at the bottom and review and carry over things from your to the next day. So it helps you really prioritize tasks and gives you little tips to be mindful of along the way. So these are some good resources for us to use. So let's talk about some real time management hacks that really do work. I'm all about how to make things as easy for us in a course of our day as possible. And here's some things that I have highly suggested to people, and some of which you're probably gonna say to me, Lisa, what are you talking about? Right? And I've always heard people say, do this, and I'm going to tell you why not to do it. So scheduling your day in advance. I can tell you that, and I have done this for forever, I set up my next day in advance. So I know at 7 or 8 o'clock today, whenever I look at my schedule to get ready for tomorrow, I already know what I'm going to tackle tomorrow. And I plan it in my planner today. I might carry over some things that, you know, from the emergent planner that I use, I might carry some of those things over. However, when you plan in advance, it gives you the opportunity, right, to have a clear vision of what it is that you need to accomplish tomorrow. And back to one of the things that we saw on the earlier slide, it'll help get those things off of your brain at night, right? So you're no longer thinking about it when you should be getting a restful sleep. Get up earlier. I'm an early riser. I don't know about anybody else. And I often feel because I get up earlier, which is 5 a.m. for me, I get more done in the course of my day than the military. Because I get it done, I get up early, right? And I can put a lot more focus on things like, you know, I get up early because I want to exercise at 5. And I can, you know, get in many other things too that are important to me and help me set up my day. So I'll be successful that day. Pack my lunch, I'll make sure I got my water, right? So everything that I need for the day. Communicate the day's agenda clearly to all your team members. And we're going to talk about that in a minute in detail about the art of delegation. And just trying to make sure that we indeed are having the right conversations with people. Okay, so we got a question. So I'll come back to your question in just a minute. Thank you for that. Stop procrastinating. Oh my gosh. So how many times have we like avoided doing something because we just, something about it causes us heartburn, right? I don't know what it could be, right? It could be many different things that can stress us out, but because it stresses us out, we tend to avoid it. And when you avoid it, it causes you to now have to deal with it at the last minute, thus creating the frustration and stress in your day. Here's the one that we have heard probably so many times in our lives, multitasking. People used to encourage us in school to multitask. I tell you to stop multitasking. The multitasking causes you to not really truly give your focus to the things that are most important. And it will pull you away to start working on things that really are not as important as they should be, right? To take up that part of your day. And so I encourage you to stop multitasking. And again, think back to what we talked about with the four quadrants, right? Put your focus in quadrant 2 and things that you plan and that are most important and those low-level tasks that bleed over into your multitasking are not in this space, right? It's not, should not live in that space. Break large tasks into bite-sized pieces. So, you know, you can never really eat anything or devour anything that's big, right? That you can't really wrap your hands or your mouth around, right? And so you take a fork and a knife and you break it into smaller bite-sized pieces. That's the same thing with large tasks, right? How can you get it accomplished if even just looking at it can seem overwhelming? And you want to figure out how to break it up into little pieces, which also gives you a sense of accomplishment, right? So when you can get multiple little pieces accomplished towards the bigger task, then you feel that sense of accomplishment and you see that things are actually getting done and completed. The art of delegation, we're going to talk about that in a minute. And then end the day on a good note. Oftentimes we can end our day feeling defeated because we were overwhelmed by things and the frustrations that other people might have dumped on us. But I say, you know, reposition the way you think about it and think about the day was a good day, right? And what about it was a good day? Because you need to replicate what made it a good day. If it was a challenging day in some way, then learn from that and then figure out how to do better the next day. Don't actually beat yourself up about it. Just figure out how to course correct the next day. Well, we're trying to advance people. For whatever reason, we're not advancing the screen here. Technology. Do you love it? There we go. All righty. So here's the art of delegation. This is the actual process. And, you know, we all need help, and we should solicit help when we need it, especially when we have low kind of low level tasks. And being able to have someone to help us with things that really take up too much of our most important time. And so I say choose the appropriate task, right? And choose the appropriate person who's capable of driving that task forward successfully. Set clear objectives and plan. So this is the piece right here, right? That if you don't set up the clear objective and plan and clearly communicate it to everybody, right? One of the things that I know from my time in HR and leading people is that you have to make sure that everybody who's participating or who's a stakeholder in the task has the clear expectations that you've set the objectives with everybody. And that you've had kind of that level set conversation to even ask them to repeat back, right, what they heard you say. Sometimes people hear things in different ways, right? And you might have to reiterate what you said a couple of different times to make sure that the person heard you correctly. I find it that, you know, sometimes people are aggravated at the fact that someone might not have gotten the message the first time. And you say, well, you know, I told you what to do. Well, we might have told them what to do, but at some part of time, it might have gotten lost in translation. They might have not completely understood it. Maybe we spoke to them very quickly, hastily, right? They didn't grasp it. So it's easier at the onset to repeat it and maybe rephrase it a couple of times. Versus we get all the way to the end of this process and realize that the expectation really wasn't met. And so now we have an issue, right? So setting the clear objectives and plan is key. Implementation. So we want to make sure that we've identified all of the resources, the tools, even the people that need to be part of the process, right? So maybe you gave your assistant the task. You gave the task to the assistant because this person has experience in this particular area. You set the clear objective. And now it's, again, to talk about the plan and how. The implementation is the how they're going to get it done. Monitoring, right? So monitoring might be, maybe you say, you know, at 2 o'clock every day, let's have a check-in on what you're working on and the progress that you've made today. So at that point, the monitoring will give you the opportunity to evaluate and review where they are in the process. And if there is the need to maybe go back and reset what the objective was, or to say, right, carry on, things are going great. So it gives you that comfort, gives you peace of mind, right? That the task is being completed according to the expectation versus we leave things kind of to somebody else's interpretation, or something might happen. And the individual that you gave the task to doesn't necessarily know how to fix the problem. If you step into the monitor space in the process, we'll give you that time to then say, oh, okay, wait a minute, that happened, right? So let me tell you how to fix that problem or how to course correct. Making sense? So manage stress caused by multiple demands. So the average business professional has 30 to 100 projects on their plate. Modern workers are interrupted 7 times an hour and distracted up to 2.1 hours in the course of their day. This may be why more than 40% of adults say that they lie awake at night plagued by the stressful events of their day. So let's talk about the steps that we can take to manage the stress caused by multiple demands. So act rather than react. We experience stress when we feel that situations are out of our control. It activates the stress hormone that we have, and if chronic, it wears down our confidence, our concentration, and well-being. I advise that you identify the aspects of the situation that you can control and the ones that you can't. So I'll repeat that again. Identify the aspects of the situation that you can control and accept the things that you can. And then accept it and move on. And react. Rather than react. Take a deep breath. If you're feeling overwhelmed, or coming out of a tense meeting or conversation and need to have a clear head. A few minutes of deep breathing will restore your balance. Eliminate interruptions or disruptions. While you may not have control over the interrupters, you can control your response. I advise responding in one of three ways. Accept the interruption, cut it off, or diagnose it's important and make a plan. So three things: accept the interruption, cut it off, or diagnose its importance and make a plan. So one of the things that people know most about me is they feel like they're in therapy often when they talk to me. And that's because I intentionally, in stressful situations, will lower my tone of voice. And it causes me to calm down and to listen, even though I'm stressed by the interruption that they might be making in my day. And in that process is when I work through these three things. I am not at all afraid to say no, that I can't. And I'll tell you why I can't accept the interruption. If it's something that I think now has been brought to my attention that I didn't necessarily have line of sight to, then I will say, you know what, duly noted, and let me get back to you on that. Change your story. Your perspective of stressful office events is typically a subjective interpretation of the facts, often seen through a skewed filter. However, if you can step back and take a more objective view, you'll be more effective and less likely to take things personally. Cool down quickly. Breathe in your mouth and out through your nose, right? As if you're sipping through a straw and then you breathe out normally through the nose. Done right, you'll feel yourself cooling down. You'll feel like, now I can hit the pause button a little bit and give myself time to think about the response. So I can tell you again, right, when people displace their emotions on you, or, you know, maybe their communication was ineffective when they were speaking to you, can cause us to immediately react. And it's all about how you respond and cooling down, right? You can manage the situation by your response if you take the approach to cool down quickly. Identify self-imposed stress. Learn to stop self-imposing stress by building your own self-confidence rather than seeking others' approval or self-sabotaging. Shift your focus and let your work speak for itself. Here's where oftentimes we, you know, are trying to meet others' expectations, which we have to, right? A lot of times we, you know, it's our employers, the people that we report to, we have to meet those expectations. However, you know, if you are working at the top of your ability, that you are giving it 110%, the work will speak for itself. Do not internalize or self-sabotage yourself by bringing into the equation your own self-imposed stress. Influence others. Even if you're responsible for your behavior and outlook, you're still left dealing with other people's stressful behavior. I advise confronting a problem, coworker, or an employee by stating that the bad behavior is that the bad behavior should be communicated to them in a respectful tone. Describing the impact that their behavior has on the team or on you personally, and requesting that they make a change. So it can be difficult to have a conversation with someone who is bringing their less than best to a conversation, right? Their stressful behavior to you. And here's kind of how I create a script for myself. And when you create this script for yourself, it allows you the capability to fall back on the script because it's easy, right? You practiced it in your head. It's kind of your generic go-to script, right? So when someone brings their stress to me, you heard me say that I will lower my voice. And I will listen for a few minutes. And then I will say to them, and here's my script. I appreciate all of what you're sharing with me. However, this heightened emotion is unproductive to us both. I think we might need to take a break for a second and let's refocus. I didn't add to the stress by going off, right? Because again, our immediate response is that we want to handle the situation in our own emotion. However, I just modeled the right behavior for this person. And so what you're now doing is teaching this person a better way of communicating, if nothing else, but with you. So they now know that when Ivy uses this script, that The next time you come to Ivy with a situation and you might be highly emotional, Ivy is going to defuse the situation. So this person will think better of it the next time that they come and communicate with Ivy, because Ivy's going to defuse the situation by her generic phrase. Make sense? So now I saw us, we had a couple of people who asked a question. So let's see if I can pull up what the questions were. Oh, I see everybody. Let's see, where's our question? All right, here we go. Thank you all for giving questions. I love questions. Okay. So one of the questions came in, it says, do you have an actual book planner you use and recommend? So the one that I use was the one that I showed you, which was that one called Emergent, the Emergent Planner, E-M-E-R-G-E-N-T, I think, or G-A-N-T Planner. You can find it out on Amazon is where I always get it. And if you're somebody who just loves to have access to pen and paper, right, that you can, you know, jot things down and make those corrections, it's the perfect plan. So let's see. Thank you, Zelda. I love that, right? It's amazing how some of these things really, right, can be transferable in our personal as well as professional lives, right? I love it. So anybody who knows me, every time I show up with you all, I love to take any questions that you might have. So if you want to unmute yourself, please, let's see if we can do that. I'm going to get on my camera here. So, so anybody have anything that you want to share with me? Any questions that I might answer for you?
Mine's more of a comment. I found myself getting kind of emotional partway through because it's almost like you gave us permission to act in a way that I already feel is the right way to behave or to think. And so it kind of reinforced the idea of how to organize and how to behave. So it was actually, I'm grateful.
Nice. I'm glad. Thank you for that. That's awesome. So anybody else?
Would you put the four squares back up on the screen for a moment for me?
Sure, yeah.
I would love to take a screenshot of that.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Okay, so let me go back.
Yeah, I photographed that too. And when I asked about the planner, I was wondering if there's a planner that has, you know, something like that, because that would be a great way to organize the day.
Yeah, I came up through the Franklin planner method.
Oh, the Covey?
Yeah, uh-huh. But I've been trying to get down to a smaller planner.
Right. The Covey one is huge, right?
Yeah, it is. It's huge.
Okay, so what happened to my share?
It was there and then it disappeared.
Right. Okay, so let's see. Here we go. Let's try this. What happened? Where did it go? Did it not show up again?
No.
Interesting.
It flashed up there for about 30 seconds.
Right.
Just long enough for me to go, oh, let me click. And then
okay,
it
so
was
let
gone.
Me, all right, so let me try something. Let's go back here. So I did a new share. Let me take me off of video. Let's see if this will do it.
Yes.
Here we go. We're getting to it, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so that was the Emergent Planner. See, the Emergent Task Planner. Let's see. Let's go back here. There we go. That's what we're talking about. That's the ticket.
Absolutely.
Well.
Got it.
There we go.
Ah, got it. Thank you.
Yeah. So, you know, I actually, I use a virtual assistant. And I don't necessarily need a lot of hours with her throughout the course of my month. But I very specifically have time with her so she can take care of some of these low-level tasks that I have that are in these quadrants 3 and 4 for me.
Miss Lisa?
Yes.
When you say you have a virtual assistant, what does that mean? You have somebody that you guys touch base online, or is it an application or what?
Yeah. So I have someone, her name is London.
Cool.
And London actually works for me probably 10 or 15 hours out of the month. And she helps answer emails for me. She does invoicing. She then sets up a lot of my social media that I circulate. Anything that I need her to do, right, that I consider that is kind of time wasters for me and causes me not to be able to operate up here in quadrant 1 and 2,
nice.
I give to London.
That's awesome.
Okay. Interesting.
So, yeah, because sometimes it does require, you know, that I have somebody to respond immediately, and she knows kind of what my response would be. And so I, you know, kind of given her the autonomy to respond on certain things. Okay, Francine, let's see what Francine said.
So my question is, like, London is a real person, right?
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
And sure how is. Do you communicate? Would you communicate rather? Is there a specific way you like to communicate?
Yeah. She and I actually have a quick little touch base for probably 30 to 45 minutes by phone. I give her the update on what I've got going on and what I should expect to see in my email or different things that I might be working on that week, just to get her in sync with me. And then as you know, she mans one of my email boxes, those emails that I kind of prepped her for will come her way. Fervor is another site that you can get somebody to do really anything for you on Fervor. You know, there is an app you can go out and set up kind of a, you know, proposal for what you are looking for. Mm-hmm. And there are people who will immediately respond back and let you know, right? So I have somebody who maintains a database for me a couple of times a year, and I get them from Fervor. And it's pretty cheap to do it. So there's lots of different resources that we can bring into the equation, right? And when you think about it, when it's this low level work, it's not, you know, it's not really benefiting you and the real business at hand, right? The things that you should be focusing on, just give it to somebody else to do, right? It's probably worth $100 of your time, right? A couple of times a month to pay somebody $100, right? Through Fervor. Or any other of these, you know, or use some of these apps that I showed you are free apps. The ones that we had on one of the slides are free. And, you know, to really kind of, automate some of the things that you have in the course of your day.
Thank you. And also I wanted to ask, is that possible to have the first picture with a hand?
Yes.
Please.
Yes. Let's see, we got one.
I love these pictures.
There we go. Oh, I love her eyes, right?
Yeah. I like this one, yes. Thank you.
Right, that like says it all, right?
Yes, like, exactly. Oh, that's exactly, yes, thank you.
That's right.
All righty. Well, I have almost taken you all to your full time with me. Is there anything else I can do for you today?
I have a what would you do kind of situation question.
Sure.
I mostly costume supervise, and most of my offices are several people in one room. So, for example, my last 3 shows, it was myself, my PA, the designer and the assistant designer. And, you know, I'm trying to do 50 things at once, and I'm finding the constant interruptions of people just kind of voicing, oh, this has to get done, or would you put this on your list, or, you know, but it's kind of constant. And I find that that interrupts even those small interruptions, and I feel like I can't do anything about it because the desk is right there. It's not like, so what would you do?
Right. So Zelda, here's where you get to manage in the delegation process, right? So you get to manage people in this process. Mm-hmm. What I would suggest is have them write these things down as they come up. And then set a specific time in the day. If it's 3 or 4 times a day, right? Maybe, you know, every 2 hours you all sync up and compare notes, right? What do you have? What did you come across, right? And then you decide at that point how to manage that part of the task, right? But to train them to also manage their time better, right? So manage their time better with the less interruptions. So it causes less interruptions for you. And I think it's about how you explain it to them, right? It caused just what you said to me, the multiple interactions and interruptions are a little difficult to manage. Let's try this, right? Give each one of them a little sticky note, a pack of sticky notes, one of these little small pads, and say, when something comes up, write it on this. And at 2 o'clock, at 3 o'clock, or whatever the time is, we're gonna sync up and talk about it, and we'll figure out how to put together a plan. So you heard me say earlier, right, the 3 things that you do: either you accept the interruption, or you cut it off, or you diagnose it, and then create a plan for it. So what you're then now going to do is you're going to take, you know, not accept the interruption, you're going to tell them to write it down, and then you're going to diagnose whether or not it does require a plan to address the issue.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, because I found myself saying all the time, you know, every time you, it's almost like it's the thought, and so the thought has to, you know.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and but I've said to them, every time you, you know, voice what's going on in your head, or every time you stop me, it stops me. And then, yeah, then they'll complain later, like, well, how come you didn't get all this done? It's like, but you know, every time you stop me, it stops me.
Right, right. And so now what it also does is it stresses you, because this is one more thing that mentally you got to try to keep track of.
Right.
Right. So nowhere in this does it involve planning, right? This is just somebody who's now dumping something on Zelda for Zelda to now remember to take care of. However, right, it's not that it's not important, it's just not the right time for us to be having this constant dialogue, right? So write it down, let's sync up at whatever time Zelda says, right? And let's compare notes. And then now we'll decide whether or not we need to make a plan to address the issue.
Right, thank you. I might get them all little notebooks. That'll be the Zelda.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Maybe like a neon color, and like, okay, write it down on the neon color, and you know, that's a good idea.
Right. Yeah. What else? Alrighty. Well, I appreciate you all and letting me come hang out with the cool kids again today. I love it. And as you all probably hear me say often, you know, I am very much invested in the guild. So anytime that I can be of service to you, you let me know. I love coming to talk to you all about things that are relevant to you. So, you know, anything that comes to mind that you want to know more about, you know, I think Ivy is always interested in hearing, so we know how to put together these kinds of webinars that are kind of mission focused, right? Things that are going to be impactful to your business. So as always, thank you again. I appreciate your time, and you all have a good rest of your day.
Thank you.